Listening Library presents Isabel in Bloom by Mae Respicio. Read for you by Danice Cabanela, with a note read by the author. To my grandmothers, Rosa and Dionysia, whose bountiful gardens I always keep with me. Seed. Home. I walk with my grandfather through 1,000 shades of green, plants dressed in dew, flowers flooded in light, as birds fill the trees with their wild, loud songs. Our garden comes alive in mornings. Lola drags a hose, the water trickling slow. We pause at a planter of jasmine sampaguita. Weeks ago, when I found out I'd have to say goodbye, he made me plant it. "So when you return, you'll see how it's grown," he said. Jasmine sampaguita takes up most of this space. Rows of shrubs like fences, small white flowers perfuming the air with their sweet, lush musk. But we hover over mine, concerned, leaves wilted, brittle brown stems. No blossoms here. I crouch down. "What's wrong, little Jazzy?" I ask, almost expecting a reply. Plants respond to humans, our voice, our love. It's why I name and talk to some of ours. Elvis Parsley and Vincent Van Gogh. My favorite, the Spice Girls, a cluster of herbs named after a music group my friends and I dance to when we play our CDs. Should I have grown it in the ground? Or in a different pot? Or something? I ask my grandfather. I don't know what to do.
"You should trust. It's just a little thirsty."
Jasmine sampaguita has gifted my family our livelihood by learning the art of growing and selling. Its blooms are our survival. I know its petals, soft and white. I know its smell without it near, but I don't know why this one looks how I feel. Homesick, heartsick, when I haven't even left for California yet. I sigh.
"Feeling nervous for your trip, Isabel?"
"If I don't like it there, can I come home?" To my surprise, he nods.
"But only for visits."
Tricked. Lola raises my chin so our eyes meet.
"Sumpakita sounds like sampaguita. It stands for I promise you. And I promise you will do fine in your new home."
He lays the hose, slips it a drip, saying something I've already heard many times my whole life. We bloom where we are planted. Don't want to say it. Goodbyes look like summer in my small town. Green hills and rice fields. My best friends and I strolling toward home. Goodbyes sound like chattering about school and friends, how next year we all turn 13, though they'll be here and I'll be elsewhere. Goodbyes taste like tart calamansi from Lola's tree, round, small, and green that Lola's slicing and squeezing into drinks. For me, Christina, and Rosamie. Ice clinks. Glasses sweat. We take slow sips and our lips pucker from the sweet and the sour. Goodbyes smell like sampaguita flowers. Lola's picked and strung, piled high on the table in soft pearly mounds.
"Bye, Lola! See you tomorrow, Isabel," my friends say.
Lola waves back and drapes a single jasmine garland around my neck the way she does with each fresh batch. Goodbye is Lola's sad smile, the waning sun that's citrus still on my tongue. These white blooms near my heart, her warm hand on my cheek, knowing how much I already hate saying goodbye. Me, Isabel Ligaya,
age 12.
I've never lived in a city. I've never seen snow. I've never been rich. I've never had a mother take me to a mall. I've never left the Philippines or ridden in an airplane or wanted to make new best friends because I love the ones I already have.
Lunchtime. On my last day at school, I sit with Christina and Rosamy at our normal spot under the giant balete tree. Its thick, gnarled knots sunk deep, making me wonder what encantos and tree fairies might live there. I take out my normal lunch, rice and meat, juice, a cookie, and Rosamy takes out something wrapped with a ribbon.
Open it!
Inside, a beaded bracelet with three dangly hearts. Those hearts are us, so you don't forget your best friends. They hold up their wrists, matching dangly hearts. I slip mine on, wrap my arms around her, and shake my head fiercely. I don't even want to go.
Then let me go for you, says Christina,
and my friends since forever laugh. Even though I know Christina's a little jealous, she told me so. I try not to cry, but Rosamy, well, she's a waterfall. I change the subject to Mark Santos, our group crush, and we're eating and talking and laughing again, just like normal. Lunch is almost done, so I run to the bathroom, but when I return, I see they're eating and talking and laughing again, just like normal. As if I'm already gone. Without Mama. I used to wonder when we'd reunite again. Finally, it's time. 5 years ago. When I was 7, life was good but hard. Good meant playing with friends through the countryside, eating green mango soaked in vinegar and salt while watching Lola prune trees, the mountains behind him climbing up to the sky. Hard meant Lola cutting the tips of my shoes to make room for my growing feet. Mama working many jobs because sometimes Lolo got sick, needing medicine and care. Good but hard, because even though my toes poked through at the end of the day when the sun sank and shone its low light, I'd stroll with Mama and Lola down pathways, and we'd walk and talk and watch as the sun went down. Hard but good, because even though I wished for new dresses and books, or to do fun things instead of my own job washing laundry for extra pesos, I had my friends. I had my school that I loved. I had a mother who said, "One day, Isabel, things will be different. You can dream and do." She always told me that. "I can dream and do, too," she said. "I'm going to help us. I have a plan. A sacrifice." That's the word I heard it called. I didn't know what she meant or how her plan would change my path. How it started. Mama left because of brochures. Looking for overseas Filipino workers. Brochures for cruise ship maids, cruise ship cooks, hotel maids, hotel cooks, nurses in hospitals, nurses in care homes, nannies for families. In places like Hong Kong, Saudi Arabia, Japan, England, Australia, America. The cruise ship brochure had bedrooms for princesses, blonde kids with big smiles, slipping down water slides, and happy, silent servers working mile-long tables topped with towering cakes. In every brochure, the workers looked like Mama. The kids looked nothing like me. One night, While my family slept, I snuck looks and flipped pages, wondering about those kids, their lives, imagining how it felt to rush down a cool water slide.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.